Well, thank you, Nehal, for this lovely introduction. And indeed, we have had many opportunities to work together and talk over the years. And he was part of our indicator project early on and has carried it forward to investigate issues like corruption and so on while he's here. It's a great honor to be a speaker at the EUI, which I have always seen as a place of real intellectual ferment and creativity. And it's delightful to have so many young people here working, learning more about these issues and living in a European environment of the sort that we hope will continue. I want to say a word before I begin my talk that I have been working on this project since 2008, thinking about indicators and quantification. There have been recent political changes that have given a new spin to what I think about this. So I just want you to know that there's a sort of a, if I could say it, I hate to say this, pre-Trump and post-Trump analysis going on here. So what I'm going to talk about today is my work on quantification and its role in governance. And I want to say in the beginning that my focus is really on quantification as a tool of governance, not just on using quantification at all. People have understood my book as being a critique of quantification per se, and it by no means is that. What I really want to talk about is the need to be more thoughtful about what numbers can and can't tell us, and the importance of combining quantitative knowledge with the kinds of deep ethnographic qualitative material that, frankly, anthropology provides. And I began this project because I was concerned that anthropological knowledge was in some ways being forgotten in comparison to quantitative knowledge, which is seen as the way to make policy. So I began with a concern about that issue, but also recognizing that numbers are very important in understanding the world, and that's really, we need to understand what quantification will do and what it won't do. So this is an effort to think about the pros and cons of various approaches to quantification, and particularly with reference to its role in global governance. I'm not talking about science. People have said, oh, you don't like numbers. What about climate science? It's really about how we use this as a form of governance. I've added the bureaucracy piece recently. You'll see where this goes with it, where I go with it. So I'm going to begin by talking about the really rise in a concern with numbers. An intense preoccupation with numbers seems to be sweeping the world these days in both international and domestic governance, based on the idea that political decisions have to be made on the basis of objective, quantified data. The use of statistics in governance is really as old as the emergence of the modern nation state. And with globalization, the scope of quantification has expanded. The creation of the UN in the 1940s happened along with the creation of something called the UN Statistical Commission, which took upon itself the task of not only developing statistical capacities for the UN, but developing ways of guidelines to create measurement systems for the whole world, poverty, economics, and then increasingly gender and social affairs. So this expansion of statistical knowledge as the basis for governance then became globalized in the 1940s and 50s. This is not only in the domain of actual governance decisions, but we see this expansion in the use of numbers to make policy decisions in all sorts of areas, as a way of developing strategies for solving problems, to holding governments accountable, in domains of social life, such as performance reviews, school evaluations, NGO monitoring and evaluation programs. So we see this use of numbers in governance expanding rapidly all over. By the 21st century, we find that quantification is really fundamental to global governance. One of the most dramatic examples of this has been the extent to which the current development agenda is now being governed by specific quantifiable goals. After 15 years of the Millennium Development Goals between 2000 and 2015, there is now a new regime of development governance under what are called the Sustainable Development Goals, or the SDGs. Maybe you all know about this, which is a much expanded set of goals. 17 goals, 169 targets, 231 indicators to be used as ways of measuring development. I mean, they include things like access to justice with little tiny indicators, but the point is these are expansive, and yet the idea is that you can do better development if you have these particular specific numbers of things that you have to accomplish. And some people argue that this then leads to very narrow, non-holistic development plans. Others say it holds countries accountable for their development. But the point being that we are now conceptualizing lots of policies in terms of specific measurable goals. And I wanted to ask, what does this mean for us? What are the effects of this move to quantification and governance? Now, as I prepared this lecture in honor of Max Weber, I began to think about the relationship between governance by numbers and bureaucracy. And interestingly, this is not a relationship that's really been theorized. I've spent a lot of time reading the quantification literature. It says relatively little about bureaucracy. The bureaucracy literature says a little about numbers, and yet, when you think about it, these two go very closely together. The expansion of quantification and the expansion of bureaucracy happened simultaneously in many ways, in complementary ways. Statistical knowledge is fundamental to bureaucratic governance. And I'm going to show how this kind of statistical knowledge gets generated by looking at an example of measuring violence against women and how this then becomes part of the way bureaucracy works. My argument is that bureaucracy and quantification work well together because they share a similar approach to knowledge. Both rely on forms of knowledge that are thought of as objective and rational, but it's in the production of this quantified knowledge that I want us to focus and begin to think about how it gets produced and what it means and what the implications, therefore, are for the nature of how bureaucracy functions. The essence of bureaucracy, according to Max Weber, as you all probably know, is that it does business according to calculable rules and without regard to persons. Weber says it's most developed when it is dehumanized, when it succeeds, in his famous phrase, in eliminating from official business love, hatred, and all purely personal, irrational, and emotional elements which escape calculation. So you can see by definition the way he talks about bureaucracy is really the kind of work that does that takes place when you convert the sort of messy social life into numbers. So I'm going to, in this talk, explore the relationship further between bureaucracy and quantification, and then ask, you know, what does this relationship mean, and what role is bureaucracy possibly going to be able to play in a world that now looks like it's emerging with a more charismatic style of leadership, cultural nationalism, new kinds of populism. How can this interface between bureaucracy and indicators function together in this new political regime? I'm not really going to answer that question, by the way. I'm going to toss it out to all of you. What are the, sort of asking, what are the prospects that bureaucracies armed with numbers can resist these current trends towards populist charismatic leadership? This is actually a novel perspective on bureaucracy. We tend to think of it as stodgy and resisting change and having a very limited perspective on what it can do. But my question really for you all to ponder is whether or not bureaucracy might serve as some kind of a bulwark against charismatic populist leaders with nationalist agendas, since it represents rationality and objectivity free of personal connections. This is certainly possible. So this is the, you know, what bureaucracy might be able to do. On the other hand, based on my own work on quantification and power, the capacity of bureaucracy depends on the quality of the numbers that it uses. Fair and rational decisions require fair and accurate numbers, and this is the issue that I want to begin with. As I'll show, I hope, in the rest of this talk, many numbers used for governance are shaped by political considerations, pre-existing cultural categories, the viewpoints of experts, and the costs of gathering data. They tend to follow established templates of counting and assessing. They sometimes produce misleading and even distorted pictures of situations. They are often impervious to challenges. If groups are unhappy about how they're being measured, there's not much they can do about it most of the time. They are also seductive. And I picked this word because I think an important dimension of these systems of quantification I'm talking about is that they offer simple and readily understandable information about highly complex social phenomena, such as corruption, the rule of law, or violence. Quantification turns these vague concepts into things that can be counted, compared, and ranked. As, for example, we see in ranking systems such as the Freedom of the World, which ranks all the countries according to whether they're free, partially free, or not free, not so easily measured, as you can imagine. The Corruption Perceptions Index, which measures the degree of corruption, but again, this is either views of it, is it actual practices of corruption? It's very difficult to measure this. Then, of course, there's the World Happiness Report and the U.S. State Department Trafficking in Persons Report. Now, I looked at three case studies, one of which was trafficking. I'm not going to say more about it today. But the trafficking world is one that is endlessly concerned with how many people are trafficked. But this is extremely difficult to know because the category of trafficking itself is very blurry. Poor labor conditions is not quite the same as trafficking. Prostitution is often equated to trafficking. So it's a murky, blurry area. By converting this into numbers, it becomes more specific. So these projects that produce these kinds of measurement systems find ways to count freedom, corruption, happiness, and trafficking, all of which are complicated and hard to track down and measure. And as they do so, they inevitably shape and define the thing they're measuring. And this is a really important point. We don't exactly know what trafficking is, or rule of law is, or even happiness. But if you measure it, then you have, in fact, produced the thing that you are actually trying to measure. So just to give a little history, governance by numbers and bureaucracy grew together, but I think I won't say more about that. So what we have is a kind of historical parallel between these. And as I said, the literature on quantification and bureaucracy is actually quite distinct. But I argue that there are actually many ways that they're quite similar, why they go together. So first I argue that they are compatible because they have a shared approach to the construction of knowledge about the social world. Both create ways of understanding the complicated and messy social world through classification and categorization. In order to count something, you have to have a category into which to put these specific instances, and you have to be able to classify something into one or another of those categories. And that is the essence of quantification. This form of knowledge inevitably strips social action of context in order to make it commensurable across lines of nation, culture, and class. I'm going to talk in some detail about how this was done with violence against women. Homogenized, decontextualized categories, such as gender-based violence or trafficking, extract behavior from its surroundings and idiosyncrasies and present it in a way that can be counted. Thus, this process of knowledge production creates the conditions for the exercise of objective, impersonal rationality that's the basis for the authority of modern bureaucracies. Quantification is also fundamental to bureaucratic practice, to the way bureaucrats operate. Numbers create the information bureaucracies use to do their work. Administrators need to know about populations and their activities. Quantitative forms of knowledge production are necessary to convert this messy world into numbers and categories that can be bureaucratically managed. Quantification makes living and breathing persons and lives into comparable objects, and such knowledge is really fundamental to the ordering of the modern state. I think there's a second compatibility between bureaucracy and quantification as well. Quantification protects bureaucratic decision-making. It provides legitimacy for what bureaucracies do. The objectivity and rationality of numerical data provides clear evidence to support bureaucratic decisions. For example, cost-benefit analysis, as Ted Porter argued in 19th century France, was used to decide where to put railroads. And you could say, well, there is the cost and here are the benefits of putting it here versus here, and therefore we make this political decision. Now, that use of justification for political decision sort of ignores the fact of how are you defining costs? Is the cost for a year, for 10 years? What are the benefits? Do we measure the benefits to the local community, to the larger area? These things are all cultural decisions, and yet converting them into costs and benefits enables you to make a decision that looks fair and reasonable. So this is what quantification does for bureaucracy. It presents decisions as numbers, which therefore make the decision look rational and fair. So quantification produces forms of knowledge useful for bureaucratic authority and practice, and at the same time contribute to legitimating bureaucratic activities as rational and objective. So I'm going to develop both of these points through examples of both local and international bureaucratic governance. And I'm going to start with something that may be a little bit familiar to you all, which is how one assesses merit pay in an academic department, a problem that some of you may or may not yet have encountered, but undoubtedly will. So I discovered this linkage between bureaucracy and indicator culture in my anthropology department as we tackled the very problematic issue of allocating merit pay among the faculty. There's not a lot of money at stake here, but there are grades which people care about deeply. Despite departmental discomfort, we didn't want to do this. The university insists that we divide the faculty into three tiers and allocate merit pay on that basis. How is this to be done? Even though anthropology is a deeply qualitative social science committed to untangling relationships and practices within small social spaces and attending to meaning, context, and history, when it came to deciding which faculty would receive how much of a pay increase based on merit, we resorted to quantification. All scholarly and academic activities were reduced to scores, which, added together, produced three ranks. This enabled an apparently objective comparison of some 30 faculty in terms of their contributions, despite the fact that this is a relatively small community where we all have a sense of who contributes how much. Putting this sensitive decision into numbers objectifies and insulates it from appearing to be simply the opinions of the committee which produces it or the chair who makes the final decision. Yet, as I tried to do this as a member of this committee, I wondered about the categories and the numbers themselves. Why, out of 100 possible points, a scholarship weighted at 60 points, teaching at 20, and service at 20? When I taught before at a liberal arts college, we divided our 100 points into 30 teaching, 30 research, and 30 service, a different value system being reflected in the quantification system. Yet these major differences in underlying values were never discussed in either institution. There has not been, in my department, any discussion about why publishing a book should count 60 points, an edited book 30 points, and a textbook 25. Notice that there are values underlying all these decisions. Why does a faculty member receive 5 points both for developing a new course and for advising postgraduate students? Are they the same? Who made these decisions? I was assured when I arrived that there were regular discussions about the measurement system in faculty meetings. But in the last 12 years that I've taught at NYU, we've only raised the measurement system a few times, and then just to figure out how to fit our actual work into these categories. The relative number of points for any category has not ever been raised, or certainly not the values underlying the system. So what does this reliance on a bureaucratic, rule-governed approach via numbers do for departmental governance? It renders objective what are inherently value-laden subjective judgments. It makes different activities comparable. It establishes underlying principles of equivalency, which allow administrators to make the contributions of faculty, which are in practice highly diverse, comparable. But it leaves a great deal out. It does not assess who is a good teacher or a poor teacher, who works energetically with postgraduate students and who does not, who fails to respond to emails, by the way, I'm sure not a problem any of the rest of you have ever heard of, who writes a good book and who writes a mediocre one. Thus, quantification makes a highly varied population commensurable by focusing on a narrow range of equivalents, eliminating context and history, and using countable proxies for the things one really wants to know, such as, is this person a good citizen, an effective teacher, a significant contributor to the scholarly world or not? That's really what you want to know. But instead, we count things. This is how quantification contributes to bureaucratic work. It provides the knowledge system that allows the kinds of rule-governed, consistent decision-making that is, at least in theory, the hallmark of bureaucracy, indifferent to individual love-hate issues and simply objective. At the same time, it legitimates these decisions through apparently objective numbers, ignoring the inconvenient fact that the categories used to produce them are themselves cultural constructs based on values, history, and context. Thus, quantification fits comfortably within bureaucracies, providing information in a way that facilitates rule-based decision-making and buttressing claims to objectivity and rationality. Do you do anything like this here? Is this just a crazy American practice? I don't know whether this sounds familiar, but it's an interesting phenomenon because it produces so much discomfort, and yet it does provide this ranking system that I've been busily critiquing. Of course, I'm also participating in it, so there you go. You can't really escape it. So now to turn back to the issue of bureaucracy and quantification. Max Weber defines bureaucracy as consisting of fixed and official jurisdictional areas ordered by laws, rules, or administrative practices. Activities are distributed as official duties, the authority to give commands for the discharge of these duties is stable and rule-governed, and these duties are regularly fulfilled, but only by those who have the qualifications to do so. This is his sort of classic definition of bureaucracy. These then constitute what he calls bureaucratic authority. The bureaucratic principle of abstract regularity and exercising authority based on equality before the law and a, quote, horror of privilege seeks to avoid a case-by-case way of doing business. Again, you see that's what our little departmental structure of measures does. In contrast, charismatic authority is attached to the charismatic person and disappears with her unless it can be routinized into a bureaucracy. This routinization depends on intellectually adjusting the charismatic doctrines to the needs of the social stratum that will carry the message forward. This is Weber's view of it. When such adaptation does not happen, when it doesn't become something that makes sense to those who might need it and use it, the charismatic doctrines will have little impact on everyday life or only influence a special way of life separate from the larger society. Moreover, as Weber points out, bureaucracy depends on the expert knowledge of the bureaucrats, which those who are in charge of the bureaucracies do not necessarily share, nor can they control. I was interested to read this because he talks about the fact that the so-called political master, so the head of state, for example, doesn't actually have the expert knowledge of the bureaucrats, and therefore may be kind of vulnerable to making his decisions happen because he stands in the position, again, to quote Weber, of the dilettante who stands opposite the expert, facing the trained official who stands within the management of administration. Bureaucracies, in other words, once established, are not necessarily easy to control. So you can see where I'm going with my kind of final question here. Now, there are obviously vast differences in how bureaucracies operate around the world, but Weber's model provides us a useful basic structure. Clearly, bureaucracy runs on numbers. Bureaucracies constantly gather numbers, often against the wishes of those being queried about their numbers. In an interesting study by two anthropologists, Akhil Gupta and Anu Sharma, they talk about a government program in India that's working to help poor women and children. As with many government programs, the bureaucrats see collecting data as important, whether or not the data serves any useful purpose. By the way, this is another feature of bureaucratic data collection. In fact, the program for women and children they studied, the Integrated Child Development Services, was, quote, incessantly evaluated, they say. In many cases, evaluations are demanded by international donors. This is the monitoring and evaluation part of NGO work. Gupta and Sharma found resistance to this enumeration, to this counting, both from parents who even refused to weigh their children and villagers who refused to answer surveys more generally. Some objected that they had been surveyed in the past and it had done them no good. Some explicitly refused to provide names and information. Surveillance was, the authors report, a familiar bureaucratic intervention in their lives. But poor Indian villagers who resist giving information about themselves to representatives of the government risk marginalization. They risk not being counted at all. So villagers face a difficult choice. Under conditions of neoliberalism, if they resist being counted, providing information about themselves, they may become fully marginalized from the world of civic participation and state benefits. On the other hand, if they provide information, they lose control over it and over the way their data will be reified and deployed, and they become subjects of the state without any real control. So there's kind of a no-win position for those who are being subject to this quantification procedure as they are made knowable to the state. Looks like I have a new slide. Okay, so I argue that there's a real similarity between bureaucracy and what I have called indicator culture. Now, when I say indicator culture, I don't mean a coherent culture way of life of a particular population. What I instead mean is a set of cultural practices, techniques, and assumptions about knowledge production that are embedded in particular institutional and bureaucratic settings. Indicator culture includes a body of technocratic expertise that places a high value on numerical data as a form of knowledge and a basis for decision making. Its characteristics are trust and technical rationality, in the legibility of the social world through measurement and statistics, not a self-evident point, by the way. Do you think we can actually know the social world through counting it? I think one could debate this point and contest it, but this is the assumption of the indicator world, that even happiness ultimately can be measured. I think smell is something that has not yet been subjected to measurement. You know, we can measure noise, but we haven't really succeeded in doing smell, which I've told, now the lawyers among you may disagree with this, means that it's very hard to get lawsuits based on unpleasant smells. Let's see, and on the capacity of numbers to render different social worlds commensurable. Again, not a self-evident point that we could make very different ways of life kind of comparable in some specific way. This perspective includes a pragmatic acceptance of imperfect measurement. Now, people who produce these indicators, they know that the numbers are messy, there's a lot of missing data, you sometimes use dummy variables, you may have different things measured that you have to stick together. There is a process called, which I haven't named this, I love this, called uncertainty absorption. So you have initial data collection, which then gets centralized and gathered together, and different categories get blended, and you have a final number. And in the process, all the uncertainty about the initial data collection analysis disappears, gets absorbed, and you have this, what Latour calls the center of calculation. So we're back to indicators. So people sort of pragmatically accept that these numbers are imperfect. People are skeptical about politics. They don't really want decisions made on the basis of politics. They'd rather have them made on the basis of sort of objective knowledge. Indicator culture builds on social science expertise and its claims to objectivity for credibility and legitimacy. It assumes that all things can be measured and that those measures provide an ideal basis for decision making. Adherents of this approach to governance see data as the basis for policy. Now, I'm not saying this is a terrible idea. I'm just saying that it cannot necessarily cover everything. Audit mechanisms are therefore central to management. And experts can generate commensurable knowledge across substantial differences in language, culture, history, and place, another assumption that might be worth interrogating. From this perspective, indicators enable policymakers to compare freedom in Mauritius and Mauritania, poverty in Sweden and the Sudan, and human rights compliance in Russia and Rwanda, can make these comparisons despite the vast differences between these countries, chosen only because of their alliteration, as you can tell. Okay, so that's sort of the framework of seeing indicators and bureaucracy going together. I want to say a little bit about the process of quantification itself, how this works, and its benefits for governance. It offers simplicity, rationality, and objectivity, ease of comparison and ranking, and therefore facilitates holding states or organizations accountable and exposing practices of discrimination. But it also converts widely, this may be the most important thing, widely disparate social practices and activities into instances of the same thing. They become examples of a similar phenomenon. This is a process that's called commensuration, framing diverse things into categories that can be counted and compared. It's easier with some things than others. We all know measurements of developing technology. We used to measure distance by things like feet and hands, right, physical body, and then we have developed sort of standardized measures that would cross social boundaries, although not, temperature still doesn't cross the Atlantic between centigrade and Fahrenheit. Measurement techniques have gradually developed for all sorts of things, but there's some things that are not yet measurable. They become much more difficult when they include more cultural factors, such as measuring stunting, which requires an idea of what the norm is, below which the person is stunted, or malnutrition. Again, you have to have a norm of nutrition so that you get malnutrition. It's even more difficult to measure well-being or freedom. So the challenge is to convert an idea into something that can be counted. And once counted, it can be compared. But the point I want to make is that this is an act of cultural creation. If you're measuring how many people are malnourished, you have to have a category constructed of what that means. How many live in poverty? You know, we've been fighting about what poverty means for a long time and how to measure it. What's the rate of maternal mortality? Well, does that mean if the mother dies at childbirth, the mother dies 2 days later, the mother dies in the run up to the birth because of some disease? I mean, these are all decisions made about how to measure these things that are not self-evident. All these terms are social constructs developed and refined over time. Once an issue has been converted into numbers, it can travel. It can become a global issue. Comparison becomes easier because numbers are based on this shared set of categories. So the challenge of quantification is developing these shared categories. And it is these that also allow bureaucrats to treat similar or different things the same way. So to illustrate this point, I'll describe how a phenomenon such as gender-based violence was converted into a globally measurable phenomenon by the bureaucracy of the UN Statistical Commission and the issues that are included and left out as a result. So this is one of my three case studies, which I think I'll go through fairly briefly, but it gives you an illustration of this argument I've just been making now at the UN level. So this follows a major issue, effort on the part of the United Nations to bring violence against women into the foreground as a major social problem. And there are a series of steps that I mentioned here. In 2006, the Secretary General did a major report on all forms of violence against women. There were a couple other efforts to build concern about this problem. And in 2009, there was an effort to say, why doesn't the Secretary General's report ask for more data? It was one of five major things that had to be done about violence against women. And this was to say, we need more data on violence against women. And the Secretary General asked the Statistical Commission, in collaboration with the UN Commission on the Status of Women, to come up with a set of indicators on violence against women so that data could be provided. So the survey, the idea of the Statistical Commission was to come up with the indicators which then would be a set of guidelines to be sent to all the national statistical offices around the world so that they could produce comparable data. So this was a project that had a global aspiration. It was developed through first expert group meetings where a expert on domestic violence from the UK first laid out a potential set of indicators based on UK research. Then there was a meeting of a group called the Friends of the Chair, which is the name for the subcommittees of the Statistical Commission, about 10 or 12 national representatives, mostly statisticians, who kind of ironed out what they would consider to be indicators. They took this to the UN Statistical Commission in 2010. 2011, they approved the report and the list of indicators with some of the sort of typical discussions you might find, which is female genital cutting is really too sensitive, we can't include it, and early marriage won't do because we have different marriage laws in different countries. So there was some political debate about it, but they essentially picked the same indicators that had been produced by the expert group meeting in 2007. In 2013, they produced a final set of guidelines. So they didn't actually do the statistical work, but they sent it off to the national statistical offices. The Statistical Commission people who worked on this were clear with me that they didn't know anything about violence against women, gender-based violence. And I asked them at one point, why only talk about violence against women? There's violence against men, there's homophobic violence, et cetera. And the answer was, well, this is sort of the way we've been going. This was our mandate. So again, you see the way continuity exists over time. They were consulting with the Statistical Commission to get advice on how to think about the gender violence piece of it, but basically the structure was governed by the need to have a statistically rigorous system. So the question is, what do you count? Violence against women is a highly diverse category, actually. It includes domestic violence, rape, honor killing, female genital cutting, sexual slavery, sexual harassment, stalking, dowry murders, the leveret. Those of you who aren't anthropologists probably don't know what this is, but this is a custom in which, in a patrilineal, patrilocal kinship system, if a man dies, his wife is married to the dead man's brother, which looks like she's married out of force, but in fact, this means she gets to stay in the same household with her children, so it's not necessarily a bad thing, but has been defined as a form of violence against women. Widowhood rituals sometimes. Some people suggested polygamy. So, you know, state violence, police violence and custody, rape in wartime. So there's a whole range of things. Some of these are local practices, like dowry murders. Some are more generic. But the question is, how can you count them? How can you put all these things together into some box that can be counted? There was much discussion about what to include, and various interest groups had different perspectives. There was especially a difference between the feminist activists who were involved in this and the UN statisticians. The UN statisticians wanted something that the countries would actually carry out, and the feminists wanted to be sure that things weren't missed. They wanted to maximize disclosure. They sort of wanted to talk about sexual harassment of children, which the states didn't want to do. So it was very hard to figure out what exactly to include and what to exclude. But they had to select a set of core characteristics in order to establish equivalency. And they ended up with six indicators the core ones were six indicators that covered physical and sexual violence. This is a little mind-numbing to read, I'm sorry about that, but you know, you get a sense of the sort of way things get simplified. So the six indicators separate physical and sexual violence, as if these are readily separable, which anybody who knows violence against women knows that they typically go together, by severity of violence, I'll get to what that might mean in a minute, relationship to the perpetrator, and frequency. Now, frequency was given two categories. One is for the last 12 months, and the other is during the respondent's lifetime. The theory being that people forget about things that happened a long time ago, but they would more likely remember the last 12 months. In addition to these, so I gave you the first four, notice these first four just relationship with the perpetrator. Then we have two that are only for intimate partners. And these two join physical and sexual violence, but they have two different time frames. So apparently if you are talking about an intimate partner relationship, you recognize that the violence, the physical and the sexual violence are the same. Now, there was a big debate when they were talking about this, about what does an intimate partner mean, and is this term going to carry around the world, and are people going to understand what it means, and does partner mean the same sex relationship or a marriage? Could you call it marriage, and then you leave lots of things out? Now, this is all being done in English, so we're going to get in a minute to the question of what happens with translation. They then added three more indicators, psychological violence, economic violence, and female genital mutilation. They still call it mutilation, not cutting, which is this last one is kind of interesting because there was objection to it at the Statistical Commission meeting, but nevertheless, the friends of the chair stuck it in anyway. The statisticians like this variable because it's really easy to count. You either have or you haven't had female genital cutting. It's not like domestic violence, which maybe you remember, maybe you didn't, maybe you interpret it this way, maybe it was discipline, you know, was it bad, was it not? So I think it's interesting to see what this, did you all master those, I hope? And now is this everything you want to know about violence against women globally? There are a number of assumptions here. Only women are victims, I already talked about this. Gender is an unambiguous category. Notice how this is just embedded within this mechanism in spite of the fact that we now think there's gender fluidity and complexity. It's assumed that this is a dyadic relationship, that it's a relationship between a perpetrator and a victim. Notice what gets left out, the role of the state, the police, the military, any kind of larger structural issues that might contribute. The focus is on physical sexual issues predominantly. With less attention, it's not quite clear how they're going to measure the psychological and economics. But I spent a fair amount of time studying violence against women programs in a small town in Hawaii, listening to women who'd experienced violence talk about it. And mostly what they talked about was the relationships, the trajectory of relationships over time, and the whole range of ways that they felt insulted and humiliated, name-calling, slamming doors, throwing things. The actual physical and sexual act was a small piece of the whole relationship that was leading them to feel violated. But none of this is here. Instead, the only variation that matters is age, severity of violence, relationship to perpetrator, and frequency. So it's a very simplified and limited way of understanding it. And it also assumes that these intimate partner relationships are fundamentally different, which is also probably not the case. The statisticians really didn't like this separate category of intimate partner violence because they said, look, that's theoretically, statistically included in the first four. Why do you need to have two more? And the reason is that the feminists who helped with this thought that this would encourage greater disclosure, otherwise it might be left out. So what is forgotten? Oops, what happened to my what is forgotten? There, I don't know quite why this is here. So what we don't have here is how interconnected these forms of gender violence are. Oh, I know why, I was gonna get to this later. It doesn't show how other forms of inequality, violence, military, wartime is connected. Nothing about state violence and structural violence. Nothing about vernacular understandings of gender violence and human rights. And as we'll see in a minute, there's also nothing about fear and the experience of the victim. And yet that's what you might really want to know. How many women are living in fear and anxiety? And that isn't measured. In fact, they debated about measuring and they said, it's too hard to measure. We don't know. It's too subjective. Whoops, okay, so hold on. I want to go back now to the next problem, which is, you may notice that this mechanism asked them to distinguish between severe and moderate violence. Is that an easy thing to do? Do you all know severe violence and moderate violence when you see it? Of course, it's very difficult to separate them. These are cultural constructs again. And so what they did was to debate, you know, what should it be? Should you measure injuries? Should you measure whether you went to the hospital? Well, think about that as a measure, you know, rural people, no transportation, no hospitals. Bleeding was one person's suggestion, or the nature of the act itself. And who should decide between these alternatives, or fear, impact on the victim? There was actually a survey in Australia that asked to what extent people change their everyday activities on the basis of this fear, but that was too complicated for the survey. So what they ended up was acts, and they picked a list of acts that had been developed by research by American researchers in at the University of New Hampshire, which has a list of activities which are of increasing severity. And they decided that the first of these activities would be considered moderate as long as they didn't have negative physical consequences. So these things, as long as there weren't physical consequences, were considered to be moderate violence. Have you already finished reading them? And severe violence had those first five if there were aggravated consequences, and the second list, whether or not there are aggravated consequences. So you see we have neatly sorted out the world, but you might ask yourself, does this really seem like a satisfactory way to actually decide what's a severe and what's a moderate form of violence? This is actually a theoretically important problem from a governance perspective, because there's a tendency to say, you're just making a big deal out of it. These are all moderate problems. It's really not such a severe problem as you say. So how things get sorted into severe and moderate is really important. Notice also that the list comes from American researchers and sort of the sort of global north. It's interesting that there was a committee in the committee meeting to discuss this at the Friends of the Chair. There was a representative from Bangladesh who suggested other categories. He said, maybe you should add burn, acid throwing, dropping from higher place, smash the finger or hand, this is what the report said, needle the finger, they didn't let me go to this meeting, kick in the abdomen, hit in the teeth, murder, femicide. So here's a whole other list of violations and offenses, some of which have a distinctively South Asian edge, but they were not included. Instead, we have this list, again showing how the templates come from the countries that have the experts, have done the experience before, but may actually not do justice to other parts of the world. So why not just ask women if they've experienced domestic violence or rape? But this turns out to be difficult. These are special linguistic categories that may be different. There are different ways of sorting this out. So that in Chinese, for example, I was told I don't speak Chinese, there's one word for domestic violence which means severe and ongoing violence. And if you ask that question, you get about 2% saying yes. Another one saying quarreling and squabbling, so that things get intense and may lead to hitting. You get 33% if you use that word. So using a word is difficult. You may not even have a word. And the other difficulty is that women don't always experience violence as something that's domestic violence. They may think it's discipline. They may think it's marriage. They may think they deserve it because they didn't cook the food right or didn't take care of the children right, and there are indications that this belief is fairly widespread. So if you ask somebody, have you experienced domestic violence, they may say no. And when I was doing this study in Hawaii, there were women who'd come in saying they had, you know, maybe one event. They really didn't experience much. And then they'd sit around in this room and they'd listen to other people and they'd talk about it. And they'd say, you know, I guess that was a crime. You know, I didn't think about it that way. But, you know, maybe when he forced me to have sex, maybe that was rape. So they're reinterpreting their own experience. This is not a stable and fixed phenomenon, but it's one that is part of the kind of messy reality of social life, which, in order to count, has to be crammed into these boxes of these measurement systems. So you can't really ask people in a survey if they've experienced domestic violence because they may or may not have had that experience. So direct questions are likely to be misleading since the categories themselves are variable and unstable, and I know I'm running out of time. It's safer to ask about acts in order to produce comparable results, but then much is missed. For example, you know no information about fear or stalking. So now we go back to this other slide, what is neglected. We already kind of talked about it, and you can see that what we really have is a model developed in the global north that really doesn't do justice to a lot of the complexities of the phenomenon. Is the solution to abandon all efforts to measure violence against women? Obviously not. The solution is to kind of recognize the values that underlie this, the power of certain groups to define the problem, the relative difference in how different groups have access to this technology, and to look at these numbers with a little more skepticism. I've often been accused of wanting to get rid of all kinds of numbers. The ideal approach, it seems to me, is to have some form of quantification, ideally informed by local communities, that then is combined with a much more narrative, microethnographic approach to understanding the whole complicated world, which this is an effort to measure, but not at all an adequate measure. So here you can see my arguments about how this contributes to bureaucratic governance, creates these objective categories, it enhances bureaucratic authority, it makes judgments more objective and legitimate. But as I hope you see now, these categories and classifications are cultural products, and they incorporate value judgments in unrecognized ways. Now, this is not to say numbers are wrong, but only to say that numbers are a technology of knowledge production that rests in the hands of those who have the power and the resources to do it. Getting data costs a lot of money. The expertise to set up these models is something that's not equally distributed. The resources to produce indicators and to disseminate them depend on the institutional power. So it's a technology that's theoretically open to everybody, but in practice, it really is those who have experience, who have resources, who have institutional power, who can create the definitive indicators. There are lots of drawbacks. You may miss things. They can be distorted. They inevitably simplify, as we've seen in this example. Lots of things get left out. Experiences are not included. They ignore things. And I want to just make a quick reference to the work by Tobias Kelly and his team, who are doing a study of whether or not torture of the poor is picked up. And they are doing this study in three countries. Maybe Neha knows where these countries are. I have it written down, but I'm using abandoning my text here. I think it's Nepal, Nepal, and Bangladesh. And they show that the amount of torture that poor people experience rarely gets picked up and counted in human rights techniques, because poor people view torture as just part of life. The police harass you, life is miserable, you get beaten up, and that you don't go to a documentation center of a human rights program and report it. It's only the higher level people who get tortured who report it, which gets it included in statistics. So again, you have to wonder how things get included and how they don't, how they get ignored and not even measured, and therefore lose visibility. So quantification determines on what gets noticed in a governance way and what gets ignored. And these issues of structure and resources are very important. So to return to my final question, can bureaucracies control charismatic authority? Can this be a new hope to deal with these kinds of nationalist efforts? Will these new forms of political leadership become bureaucratized over time? Will they move into this domain of counting and measuring the world in a way that reflects new kinds of value systems and therefore become entrenched? Or will they be resisted by bureaucrats who resist the political master and go back and do things in their own way? And I think the point I wanted to make in the end, this is actually my final conclusion, is that, here's my last paragraph. Bureaucracy might be able to disrupt this process if charismatic authority is not routinized, but will it move to accommodate this charisma or resist through non-cooperation, foot dragging, leaks to the media? This is a live issue in the U.S. today and possibly elsewhere, and I think it is worth thinking about the fact that the capacity of bureaucracy to resist this kind of leadership may depend on the quality of the numbers it has at hand. So, thank you very much.